the history of Springfield, Massachusetts in the King Philip War. October 5th, 1675, the town of Springfield, Massachusetts is burned to the ground. Letter from William Pynchon to Governor Leverett. That night, a post was sent to us that 500 Indians were about Springfield intending to destroy it on the 5th of October. With about 200 of our soldiers, I marched down to Springfield where we found all in flames. About 30 dwelling houses burnt down and 24 or 25 barns, my corn mill, sawmill, and other buildings. That the town did not utterly perish is cause of great thankfulness. As soon as said forces appeared, the Indians drew off, so that we saw none. Many of the inhabitants have no houses, but I resolve to attend what God calls me to and stick to it as long as I can. So what caused the uprising among the natives? Well, that's the subject of my documentary.
Hi, John Kelly. Great place to start is right here. I'm in Agawam, Massachusetts, at the mouth of the Westfield River, which flows into the Connecticut. Now, the word Agawam, actually pronounced Agam, the translation is fish curing spot. Now, the Agawam Indians had their fishing village right here on the banks at the Pynchon Landing.
Let me give you an idea of what the village looked like.
The fishing village, as in most fishing villages, would have been seasonal. Their dugout canoes would have lined the banks. This was the season of great joy and celebration. Different clans from the surrounding areas would congregate each year at the same time, same location. This season was long awaited, especially after a cold, dark winter. There would be ceremonies thanking Mother Earth for their bounty, the time of storytelling, marriage proposals, and catching up on the latest news. The children would be playing their games, and the men would be lighting up their pipes. And, of course, drying and preserving your seasonal catch.
So, how did the Native Americans survive? What did they live on?
Although Native Americans domesticated corn, tomatoes, and potatoes, their farms were generally unproductive, and most of their plant food came from gathering tubers, greens, berries, and shoots. But that's actually farthest from the truth. Three centuries ago, corn-farming Indians in today's New York State were outproducing European wheat farmers. Green beans, lima beans, pumpkins, squash, potatoes, tomatoes, corn, grapes, and many other vegetables were grown. Corn, beans, and squash, also known as the Three Sisters, were the principal crops of Native American farmers in the Northeast, and had been planted together at least 300 years before the Europeans arrived. Each family would plant about an acre of land. Small mounds would be created all over this acre. The three crops grown together are able to thrive and provide high-yield quality food source, and would often produce a surplus of food for each family. The maize provides a structure for the beans to climb, eliminating the need for poles. And the beans provide the nitrogen into the soil. Finally, the squash spreads along the ground, blocking the sunlight, helping prevent the establishment of weeds.
On the west bank of the Connecticut River was their fishing village. Now on the east bank, the very end of the South End Bridge, up top on Long Hill Street, was their fortified village.
Let's go take a look.
We're heading down Route 57 on the Agawam side towards the South End Bridge. Across the river, high on the Long Hill Bluff, is where the Native American fort once stood, a palisaded fort.
The proud Agawams, their territory once stretched from the Chicopee Falls to the Enfield Falls. In 3 short years, the population of over 1,000 was reduced to less than 18 families. In 1619, the smallpox epidemic hit the Atlantic coast hard. Population decline of 70 to 80%. 1633-1634 was heading up the Connecticut River Valley.
So here's what happened. The Dutch made more attempts to trade upriver from the Plymouth people. They were going to win the friendship of the Indians and get them to come to Hartford in the spring, past the Plymouth party. They went up to Warrenoco, now Westfield, Mass., where a group of Indians dwelt. Within weeks, they were all decimated by a plague of smallpox. 1,000 Indians perished, leaving about 50 survivors. They could not even bury their dead. These Dutch traders almost starved and froze to death before they could get away. They reached the Plymouth trading post in fatal condition in February. They were taken in by the kindness of the Plymouth people. The 4 Dutchmen were given good food and quarters for a few days and taken down to Hartford. The Dutch were very grateful for the kindness, considering the ill will between them. Unfortunately, they brought the plague with them. The Windsor Indians all fell ill and could not even feed themselves or make a fire. The Plymouth party inside their garrison post were afraid to come out and help, fearing the disease. But compassion overtook them when they learned that whites did not get the disease. They fed the Indians and fetched water and wood. Many died, including Sachem Natawanit and his family and friends. It swept through the other tribes as well. The whole Indian population was about 2,000 after that epidemic. It was estimated that this was less than a quarter of the original number. Now, desperate times call for desperate measures.
The Agawam Indians send a messenger to the governor at Boston. "We are very desirous to have some Englishmen to come plant in our country, and we offer to find them corn and to give them yearly 80 skins of beaver, and that the country was very fruitful, and wish that there might be 2 men sent with him to see the country." The governor of the Bay County at first declined the River Indians' offer. He was suspicious. They were unaware of the drastic population decline of the natives. They didn't want to become involved in an area conflict. Eventually, word got back of the devastating smallpox epidemic. Now, prime fishing and agricultural land was there for the taking.
So they invited the colonists to settle the upper Connecticut River Valley for protection. But protection from whom? The Mohawks. The Indian translation for the word Mohawk is the people eaters. The Indians along the Connecticut Valley and all over New England stood in great fear of the powerful Mohawks, especially at Agawam, where they were exposed to their marauding excursions. For defense, a fort was erected of strong poles with one end inserted in the ground and placed close together, thus making a high fence around an enclosure on Long Hill.
This is when this man comes into play. So who was William Pynchon, the founder of Springfield? Well, in April 1630, William Pynchon sailed from Southampton, England, for North America as one of the founders of the Massachusetts Bay Colony. Now, Pynchon began trading furs along the Atlantic coast, the Roxbury area, but that enterprise basically failed. One reason is taxes. It was heavy taxes on each beaver pelt. In the fall of 1635, Pynchon sailed up the Connecticut River investigating prospects for the lucrative beaver trade. He struck a deal with the Agawams in the spring of 1636 and purchased 150 acres of land.
Now this is a copy of the original purchase agreement between the Agawams and William Pynchon. William Pynchon, Henry Smith, and Jehu Burr. We agree to truck and sell the ground of Muckaquatus, or Meadow, also Akumsik, on the other side of Quanah, and the ground and of Muckaquatus on the side of Agawam, except for Cottonquash, our ground that is now planted. 4. 10 fathoms of wampum, 10 coats, 10 hoes, 10 hatchets, and 10 knives.
Now, Pynchon wanted to establish the Agawam plantation as a fur trading outpost.
And this was the ideal spot for trade with the river Indians up and down the Connecticut River Valley.
And the proximity is ideal. North, south, east, and west. You have the Connecticut River from the ocean to Canada. You have the Chicopee River heading up to Brookfield. You have the Westfield River heading on to Albany.
William Pynchon leapfrogged the Wethersfield and then Windsor plantations.
Now, Springfield is the new wilderness outpost.
William Pynchon was a businessman. He understood that if you were going to be lucrative in the business, you'd have to treat the Native Americans right.
The purchase of the land came upon a condition. The condition stated that with the sales of the land, that the Indians shall enjoy all that cottonquiche or ground that they have now planted and have liberty to take fish and deer, groundnuts, walnuts, acorns, and sassamaquiche, a kind of peas, and also if any of our cattle spoil their corn to pay as it's worth.
William and later John Pynchon honored that agreement until the day of October 5th, 1675.
Pynchon's exodus from Roxbury, Massachusetts. It was in mid-May of the year 1636 that the settlers of Springfield left Roxbury to find a home in the Valley of the Connecticut. There were not many, perhaps 20, 40. How many children, we do not know, but at least we know there were two. Their names were John and Mary Pynchon. John and Mary were both probably under 12 years old, but old enough to walk part of the way, and sometimes they'd probably ride on their father's horses. The travelers were, of course, some days, perhaps a week on the journey, for they only had the forest path to follow. Good enough for the Indians, but not good enough for the luggage and traveling with horses or cattle. At night, they made a camp around a blazing fire, and probably someone stayed awake to keep a lookout for the Indians while the others slept. When the morning broke, they read the Bible together and sang psalms before again starting on their way. Now, at last, the settlers arrived on the banks of the wide, rolling Connecticut. The shade of the forest was behind them, and here was the pleasant open spaces and rippling waters and the bright sun shining over all. To the north was a mountain outlined against the sky, somewhat like a crouched lion, but later to be known by the simple name of Mount Tom.
To John and Mary Pynchon, the Indian children must have been quite interesting as they rolled down the banks and play or shot toy arrows at imaginary game.
But when they returned the next year with the settlers in 1636, however, they found some angry Indians. For 1 year earlier, William Pynchon built a shelter on the west side of the river in a meadow. Cable and Woodcock remained that winter in that shelter, keeping cattle. Now the pigs left behind in 1635 had trampled the Indian corn. Pynchon was forced to establish his new plantation on the east side of the Connecticut River. Indian trails about Springfield. This map is pre-contact, meaning before the arrival of the colonist to the New World. This is an amazing map. Let me give you a few landmarks so you can get your bearings. Westfield River, Palisaded Fort. This is Sumner Avenue. This is the main street of today, heading to Chicopee. Right here is the Mass Pike entrance and exit. State Street. From the Palisaded Fort, we have Antonio's Grinders, Mill Street, Maple Street, Chestnut, and Bay Street. Bay Street to Oak Street to Pine Street to Long Hill. Continue across the river onto Westfield, Great Barrington, Albany, and Buffalo. Let's look at the land that the Roxbury expedition had purchased. It stretched from the Pocosic Brook, located at the foot of Barney's Hill, Forest Park, up to the Chicopee Falls. So let's take a look at the new town plot. The History of Western Massachusetts by Harry Andrew Wright. The layout, the town plot. Once again, the ancient Native American trail heading down to Chicopee Falls. This area right here is State Street that would head up. You notice it crosses Bay Street of today. That's the Bay Path, the ancient Bay Path heading to Boston. Out to the right, the former York Street was where they had their lower ferry where they crossed the river. Now to the very left was Wharf Lane. This is the location of the Peter Pan bus station of today. And very important to the town was the Hasakee Marsh, the town brook. And of course, we can't forget our future Court Square, future meeting house, and of course, the training field and burial ground. Now, it was decided that each settler's land would extend in a rectangular form and consist of about 3 acres of property apiece, and the land across the brook would be communal pasture. The pine forest above the pasture land would be the building material for the new homes. They would fill the cracks of their new log houses with clay or mortar to keep out the cold. The material for the roof would be thatch or straw or grass. Soon a mill would be erected, and the mill would be located at the present-day Mill River at the foot of Long Hill. Now, machinery for a sawmill can be got from Boston, and the result was boards and shingles and clapboards for those who could afford them. William Pynchon was awarded the first warden of the town. The warden is a civil and religious officer, or town selectman. The town meeting was the source of all local authority. The colonial law imposed a religious test on all men entering the assembly of freemen. The assembly owned and managed all the land. It apportioned it to individuals, filled civil and religious offices, built churches, hired ministers, opened and repaired roads, regulated the walk and conversation of the individual, nominated the magistrate and constable and the officers of the training band. He elected all town officers, superintendent of trade between man and man, fixed the price of labor, limited market prices, regulated the forest, determined the rotation of crops in the common, even fixed the bedtime of the inhabitants, even their season of worship and their hours of labor. Pynchon was an old hat at this.
After all, he was the selectman of Springfield once before. Well, Springfield, England. Indeed, they lived a better life than in the old country. They had to get used to much colder winters and many conveniences which they had enjoyed before they couldn't have here, but the land easily gave them enough to eat and greater plenty than England could have done, partly because of the cultivated fields and partly because of the wild game. But there was plenty of work, cutting down trees for firewood, hollowing great logs for canoes, planting corn in the spring, hoeing it in the summer, and husking and threshing it in the autumn. There's cutting grass for hay and getting into stacks for winter use. There are horses and oxen to be shod, plows mended, and all sorts of farming and domestic implements to be repaired. In a place so far away from the rest of the world as Springfield, these would sometimes need to be made on the spot. Let's look at the individual family plots in more detail. We intend that our town shall be composed of 50 families, and every inhabitant shall have a proper portion for a house lot.
I'm very fortunate to have found a map of Springfield, 1645. I think this will help me explain in more detail the Indian raid of Springfield, 1675. This will help in explaining though what had happened, where it had happened, and how it had happened.
We're at the south end of Springfield by the Mill River,
looking north down Main Street.
This location right here is at the foot of Fort Pleasant, Antonio's Grinder. Going down South Main Street, we have the McDonald's. Heading down Main Street, the future Court Square, Mullen Theater. We head down Miles Morgan's home, which is the bus station of today. What I find interesting is the property lines of that time period are basically the same property lines of today.
Here's William Pynchon's home.
Now I superimposed a map of today
on John Pynchon's property.
You notice it fits perfectly. The streets of Lyman, Worthington, there's the highway. And also the training field, State Street, Court Square, Elm Street fit perfectly with the 1645 map.
Springfield was designed to be an industrial community based on the fur trade. For its support, of course, it needed a certain amount of agricultural activities, which were imperative for their subsistence. But a self-supporting community was what William Pynchon really wanted, serviced by its own carpenters, builders, brickmakers, masons, carpenters, tailors, smiths, and artisans. Now, 3 years after the arrival to this area in 1639, there were only 14 families. In 1641, there were 19 families, and in April 1643, there were 22 families. Pynchon drew recruits from other towns. In 1643, he wrote, "The Lord hath added some 3 or 4 young men out of the river to us lately." These were Thomas Cooper, John Harmon, and Roger Pitchard from the other river towns of Hartford, Wethersfield, and Windsor.
By the year 1645, there were 50 families.
Now, a blacksmith shop was already built and operating. It's time for a meeting house.
Thomas Cooper, the new arrival from Windsor, Connecticut, was assigned to the task. Thomas Cooper was a master carpenter and would become quite prominent to the town of Springfield.
With the 50 family town limit reached, it's time to expand. Long Meadow comes into play, and also west of Springfield, West Springfield. William Pynchon and the town people are finally prospering in this wilderness area. But for Selectman Pynchon, trouble was brewing. In Pynchon's house on Main Street, he wrote a book which he got printed in London, which he gave his thoughts on his religious beliefs. It was called The Meritorious Price of Our Redemption. Because this book was in some respects contrary to the opinions then held, it caused much excitement, particularly in Boston and in the neighboring towns. The general court condemned it. By order of this court, the book was publicly burned at Boston and its author removed from his position of judge at Springfield. Well, William Pynchon had had enough. Now, he left the old world for the new world because of the religious prosecution. It's ironic, with a new king, England is less restrictive religiously as the new world. So in 1652, he leaves Springfield, Massachusetts, destination Springfield, England. But he left the town in good hands with John Pynchon, Samuel Chapin, Eliza Holyoake, and Thomas Cooper, and others who were loyal to him. John Pynchon. John actually became more important to the Massachusetts colony than his father. He maintained throughout his life the old school concept of the Almighty God. He believed and observed the Puritan resignation to the will of God, never questioning his ways or means. God's hands were to be seen in every moment of the day. He believed, for instance, that the King Philip War was God's means of punishing a sinful New England, the Indians being divinely appointed to chastise the white sinners. John was by far the wealthiest person in the Upper Connecticut Valley. His father, before leaving for England in 1651, quietly conveyed to him all his lands, about 200 acres, and his buildings and all his business enterprises. And he also received the same special privileges which had been granted to his father concerning trade with the Indians. Now, life was changing on the frontier. The deer and beaver were almost gone. Most of the Indians moved west into New York. Now the farmers were producing corn, wheat, and lumber. People were streaming into the valley and they needed land. From the Indians, he bought the greater part of the Connecticut River Valley, from Enfield and Suffield in Connecticut up to the northern line of Massachusetts. In 1659, John bought the land at Northampton for the settlers from Hartford, from the Nonotoc Indians. He laid out the towns of Hadley and Hatfield. He also purchased the land of Deerfield, Mass., and also close to the Vermont border, Northfield, Mass. It would take a full hour documentary to talk about John's business interests, but here's a brief overview. As I stated earlier, he traded fur directly with the Indians, with agents in different locations such as Westfield, Northampton, Hadley, and Albany. From there, he sent his furs down the river to his warehouse in East Windsor, called Warehouse Point. Next stop in the journey, Hartford, Connecticut, and then on to the Boston Harbor. And from Boston, we crossed the Atlantic. Shipments of English finished goods would return to stock his general store at Warehouse Point. Let's move forward, say 316 years. The year is 2016 in Springfield, Massachusetts. So what led up to the King Philip's War? I spoke at great length of the Native American culture as well as the life of the colonists and their beliefs. I think it'll help us to understand the conflict that came about between the two very different people. Now, the 17th century began an era of profound cultural changes for the Native Americans in this area. Over the previous hundreds of years or more, the lives and the culture of the Eastern Woodland Indians had changed very little. If any changes took place,
it would have involved small degrees. As I stated earlier, their environment provided them with all the natural resources required to meet their needs. Now, after the arrival of the Europeans to the shores of North America, the traditional native pattern of living were radically altered. Gradually, the Indians became more dependent on the white settlers, to the point of almost total subservience. Any prolonged contact between two societies with different cultures causes change to occur in both societies. Now, each borrows cultural traits from each other, particularly if the newly acquired trait is better than a traditional one. Initially, the English depended on the Indians, and in many instances would probably not be able to survive without their help. The natives provided the newcomers with food in times of shortages and taught them how to hunt and fish and how to live in their new environment. Once the colonists mastered the skills and learned to become more self-sufficient, they no longer needed the Indians' help. Actually, there is one thing left that the colonists still needed from the natives. It was their land.
The trading settlements provided a convenient place to barter their corn and pelts for highly coveted English goods. But by the early 1670s, they realized the terrible price they had to pay for these benefits. With the beaver trade dwindling and the wampum replaced by the English coin, the natives were heading for a storm. With no longer a reliable source of income, they quickly became indebted to the traders. And on top of that, there was mounting pressure by the Puritan government for the Indians to abandon their beliefs and accept the white man's God as the one true God. Ancient tribal rituals and customs branded by the Puritans as being morally wrong or anti-Christian were outlawed. The powwows, or the shamans, the traditional holy men and healers, held in high esteem by the Indian people, were prevented by law from practicing their craft. They had to operate underground. Gradually, the natives were being forced to turn away from their ancient ways of life and assimilate. But of course, they were never really fully accepted in the mainstream of the New England's white society. But hold on, there's more. The Puritan government of Massachusetts embarked upon an official course of action to have all the Indians in the colony confined to a specifically designed area, or independent townships, run by the missionaries. These were actually nothing more than reservations. The Native Americans called them praying towns. They were spread out through central Mass. The policy was not unlike apartheid imposed by the government of the Union of South Africa between 1948 and 1991 against the blacks and other non-Caucasians. No longer would the people be able to roam the land as they had done all their lives and countless other generations had done. And the conversion of the growing number of the people to Christianity eroded the stability of the tribe unit from within. A constant state of turmoil and unrest was created by the spread of organized religion. Opposing viewpoints often pitted friends against neighbors and even close relatives against one another. Frequent and often heated arguments between rival factions within the tribe threatened to disrupt the peace and harmony of what had previously been a close-knit group. And finally, the natives were deliberately and systematically being disposed of their tribal lands to make room for the ever-expanding white population. The Englishmen's greed for land was insatiable. Just prior to the outbreak of the King Philip War, representatives of the Massachusetts government served the Nipmuc sachems, the Nipmuc chiefs, with official notice that all vacant or unapproved land within the colony's jurisdiction would be taken over for distribution to the prospective settlers. This issue alone was the greatest contributing factor to the problem of mounting racial tension between the Central Mass Indians and the ruling white government. Now let's get this straight here.
The official notice was that all vacant land or unapproved land within the colony's jurisdiction would be taken over for distribution.
Vacant, unapproved land. Of course, the Massachusetts authorities were aware that the natives were seasonal people and didn't live in permanent villages. So basically, if the natives didn't live like the white people and didn't fence in their yards and live in log homes and have domestic cattle, and, well, basically, their property was open for settlement. What a sad day for the natives to return to their summer planting fields and find a new colonial outpost, and the helplessness of not being able to do one thing about it.
The stage was set. So who was Metacom or King Philip? He was born around the time of the Pequot Wars, about 20 years after the arrival of the Pilgrims. He knew no other world but the one in which the English and the Wampanoags lived together. Even his name, Philip, which was given to him by the Pilgrims, suggests that he was comfortable in the two cultures. He came of age in the late 1650s in a world his forefathers could not even imagine. He fancied fine English lacework and finely detailed wampum. He counted among his close friends both English and Indian, and was often seen walking through the streets of Boston. As he approached manhood, though, Philip became more aware of his father's unease. Massasoit's tribal borders has receded, and disease has continued to thin the Wampanoags. And his trusted friend, Edward Winslow, has died. And the new leadership at Plymouth had little memory of the time when they were needed. Shortly after Winslow's death, Massasoit passes away in 1661. Now, the following year, Philip's brother, Wansuta, the next sachem, died soon after making a peace treaty with the English. Suspicions were rampant that the English had poisoned him. Tensions between the Wampanoags and the colonies were reaching alarming levels. As the English expanded their settlements to include over 90 towns, the natives were being pushed continuously inland and away from the eastern seaboard. Naturally, the war was a result of a number of accumulative events, but the discovery of John Saston's body at the Aswampsips Pond would be the prime instigator. The English hanged three of Philip's men for the supposed crime, which Philip saw as an affront to his jurisdiction. Philip had had enough. He raided the outpost settlements of Swansea, Massachusetts, and the war was at hand. With each successive raid on English outposts, the Indian Confederacy grew. Nearly half of the Mass Bay colonies saw violence, and a sense of desperation began to grip many towns. After the sacking of Swansea, Mass., a taunting message from one of King Philip's men was found. "Know by this paper that the Indians you provoked to wrath and anger will war. If you will, there are many Indians, yet you must consider the Indians lose nothing but their lives, while you must lose your fair houses and cattle. James Nipmuc."
June 24th, the attack on Swansea, Mass. June 26th to 29th, the Wampanoag attack Taunton, Mass. July 8th to the 9th, Marlborough and Dartmouth. July 14th, the Nipmucs attack Mendon. August 2nd to the 4th, the Nipmucs also attack Massachusetts troops and besiege Brookfield. August 22nd, seven colonists are killed in Lancaster. September 1st, the Nipmucs and the Wampanoags attack Deerfield. October 5th, Springfield, Massachusetts.
It was in early August that a horseman came riding in hot haste into the main street of Springfield, announcing to the excited inhabitants that their neighbors of Brookfield, 30 miles away, were in great distress. The horseman was Judah Trumbull. He had left Springfield but a few hours before. Arriving at Brookfield, he had found the village in flames and the villagers penned up in a single house.
fighting for their lives against a horde of savages who were besieging it. Concealing himself, Trumbull crept up near enough to take in the situation, then rushed to Springfield as fast as his horse could carry him. Brookfield having been destroyed, it was natural to be expected that Philip would now give his attention to the settlements up and down the valley. None knew whose turn would come next. Springfield was no longer the northern settlement above Hadley and Northampton, Hatfield and Deerstorfield, and still further north, Northfield. And most exposed of all, the only settlement to the west in the valley was Westfield. Of all the forces in the valley, Major Pynchon had command, and in each town, of course, there was a military company. The Indians were now gathering in the neighborhood of Hadley, which apparently was to be the next point of attack. It was to Hadley, therefore, that the English soldiers were sent. Now, there were two schools of thought as to the most effective method of conducting the campaign. One provided for the calling out of the more active men of each town to provide a mobile army ready to promptly take to the field whenever disaster threatened. John Pynchon and many others objected to this plan, which left the individual towns unprotected. However, that group was overruled and Pynchon was given command of the Valley Troopers with headquarters at Hadley, where the forces were directed to assemble on October 5th, 1675. Before setting out on that expedition, three substantial houses were garrisoned for the protection of the inhabitants. One of these was at the extreme lower end of the town, the home of Jonathan Burt, today's Main Street and Elmwood Street, which had been built by Hugh Parsons. Further up the street, the home of the widow Margaret Bliss, which is today's Main Street and Loring Street. And the third was the fort, John Pynchon's fort. The Pynchon house, by its construction being of brick with walls 2 feet in thickness, was in itself a good defense. There were two other houses, of course, in the lower part of the street, which, although built of wood, were especially protected against assault. The ordinary means of garrisoning a house was by palisades. A palisade is basically a stockade fence of today. Basic measurements, 8 to 10 inches wide, by 10 to 12 feet long. Sometimes several houses, as at Northampton, they had a whole hamlet enclosed. Loopholes were made here and there through which those from within could fire at an approaching enemy without much danger that a bullet or arrow would enter through the loophole itself. I personally believe if they palisaded the homes at all in Springfield that they were quickly done in a crude manner. Three substantial houses were garrisoned for the protection of the inhabitants. One is on Main and Elmwood Street, the other Main and Loring Street, and Main at Fort Street. Well, let's go there and take a look. Here's Elmwood and Main. Jonathan Burt home. This is a photo from 1875. If you notice, this house is a duplex. I doubt in 1675 they had duplexes, so this must have been an add-on. And we have the corner of Loring and Main Street. The home of the late Margaret Bliss. So, what kind of training did the town have to be able to defend itself? It was mandatory that every town had a train band. What's a train band? Well, let's head to the training field. The Burying Ground and Training Field. West of the meeting house on the banks of the Connecticut, William Pynchon and Henry Smith, by order of the town, bargained with Francis Ball and Thomas Stevens. According to the report made to the town February 26, 1645, for 21.2 acres of land for a burying ground and a training field. Springfield was a wilderness outpost. The first order,
the fence.
The Train Band, under the date November 14th, 1639, is the record. It is ordered that ye, the exercise of training, shall be practiced one day of every month, and if occasion do sometimes hinder, then thee shall, like space of time, shall be observed at a later date. And ye, all above 15 years of age, shall be counted for soldier, and the time to begin the first Thursday in December next. Now, years later, in the year 1674, a new order. Every soldier, and in every dwelling of the town, was to have in their possession 1 flint musket, 6 gun flints, 30 lead shot, and 1 pound of quality gunpowder. Before we go any further, let's talk about the weaponry of that era. We're back at Court Square, standing in front of the Miles Morgan monument. So what kind of weapon is he shouldering? Looks like a large caliber barrel, and the muzzle is flared at the end. The weapon is called a blunderbuss. It's a Dutch word. Blunder, meaning thunder, and bus, meaning stick, thunderstick. It was the world's first shotgun. Adopted for defensive use, it was effective at short ranges, but lacked accuracy for targets at long range. If you were to gauge the fear factor of the blunderbuss from 1 to 10, it would be an 11. The blunderbuss was the weapon of choice when defending homes against attack. Next would be the flintlock rifle, replaced by the matchlock just 2 years prior to the King Philip War. Here's how the flintlock firing mechanism works. You have the hammer, the flint, the frizzen, and the pan. Flint strikes the frizzen, or striking surface, which creates a spark, which ignites the gunpowder in the pan, which fires the lead ball down the barrel, hopefully to your intended target. The downfall of the flintlock weapons of that era is that they were only accurate at about 40 to 50 yards. And also, the chance of your weapon firing was drastically reduced in damp or wet weather conditions. Your flint, striking surface, and powder must be dry in order for this weapon to function. It's interesting. The Indians always thought the tactics of the English in warfare was foolish. They didn't understand why they stood all clumped together when firing their weapons. Hey, easy target. Why not fire behind a tree for protection? Well, there's a reason. With the flintlock not being very reliable or accurate, 10 guns were better than 1. So what did the natives choose for their weapons? The flintlock. Yes, the flintlock. The war was many years into planning. Although it was illegal to sell weapons to the Indians, it was mostly overlooked. The natives quickly became known as excellent marksmen. This was their natural environment, and they were master hunters. Stealth, ambush, jungle warfare. So let's get down to the actual raid of Springfield, October 5th, 1675. Northampton and Deerfield had fallen, and Hatfield, Hadley, and Northampton were the next in course. In the meantime, the Indians, with the cunning which characterized them, took measures to surprise the settlement which least expected it. In the meantime, too, the Springfield Indians, who had thus far been at perfect peace with the whites, stimulated by the course of events at the north and anticipating the final triumph of the tribes, began to manifest a treacherous tendency.
The inhabitants, who had lived so peacefully with the Indians for nearly 40 years, could not attribute the incendiarism to its real source. Still, suspicion was awakened. The people of the town repaired and strengthened their fortified houses so as to be prepared for an emergency, and then questioned the Indians, of whom they succeeded in obtaining hostages for their good behavior. And these were sent to Hartford for safekeeping.
Translation, we are going to take some of your children hostage. If you promise to be faithful to the Bay Colony, we will return your children.
The Indians, then, having laid their plans, went secretly to Hartford and enticed away the hostages who had not been guarded with sufficient strictness. This was on the night of October 4th, and on the same night, 300 of Phillips Indians who, shunning the plantations, had made their way through the woods to Springfield from the north. They were admitted into the fort at Long Hill.
And here's once again when Toto from Windsor, living with the Walcott family, comes into play.
In his travels, he happened to see and speak with the band of Indians coming back from Hartford
and had learned of the plans of the destruction of Springfield the next day. The dispatch of a messenger to the doomed town was immediately effected. He arrived at the dead hour of night and gave the alarm. The tidings were carried out from house to house. Men and women leaped from their beds. The children were clothed with such haste as circumstances demanded, and then all fled, with such valuables and necessaries as they could carry, to the fortified houses. A post was dispatched to Major Pynchon at Hadley, giving him information of the plot and requesting his immediate assistance. Within the fortified houses, three in number, the terrified inhabitants impatiently awaited the light of morning.
And what a long night it must have been. Let's head down to Court Square in downtown Springfield, to the old meeting house.
If I could go back into time, I'd like to be standing at this spot. I'm at the Court Square in Springfield, Mass. I'd like to be standing here at 1675, October 5th, at around 9 a.m. I'm standing where the meeting house once stood. And they had a serious debate at that time, and boy, I'd love to hear that conversation.
So, where was the meeting house located? Well, let's go back in time. Court Square, Main Street, and Elm.
The original meeting house, built by Thomas Cooper in 1645. The building was 25 feet by 40 feet, with two turrets. One turret, the bell for Sunday services, and the second, a watchtower. So let's go back to 1675 at 9 a.m. at the Court Square.
The meeting house, Tuesday morning. The sun rose on a community of empty houses. Most likely the Indians intended on the attack that night, but with a plot being discovered and the sudden rush of people running to their homes and the meeting house bells ringing, after council, they most likely decided to cancel the raid. Now, with a morning meal and possibly religious services, courage returned to the community. With the galleries full, the debate continued. In Thomas Cooper's opinion, the raid would not go forth and went so as far as to discredit Toto and his frightful secret. And Mr. Glover, the Reverend, was easily convinced and carried his library back to his home. At some hazard, Lieutenant Cooper determined to resolve these doubts. Taking Thomas Miller with him, they both mounted, rode down the street in the direction of the fort.
The morning air was crisp and clear as Miller and Cooper mounted up and headed down Main Street. There's not much information on John Miller, but there's plenty regarding Thomas Cooper. Not only did he build the first meeting house, which we just left a few minutes ago, but he also was a farmer, and of course a carpenter, engineer, land surveyor,
soldier, trader, public administrator, also a practicing attorney.
He also operated many of the trading posts up and down the valley for William Pynchon and then later for his son John. He spoke the Algonquin language fluently and was well acquainted with and respected by the area Indians. I personally don't believe he was all that worried as he headed towards the south end of the town to visit with the Agawams up on the hill, as he had done many times before. So what happened on that fateful morning? Well, there's a monument dedicated to both Miller and Cooper located on the corner of Mill Street and Main. Let's go take a look.
Near this spot, Lieutenant Thomas Cooper and Constable Thomas Miller were killed by the Indians just prior to the burning of Springfield, October 5th, 1675. 340 years earlier, this portion of South Main Street was but a narrow strip of land. To the right was a deep ravine. To the left, swamp wetland. At the bend, a river once flowed. They called it the Mill River. As they were about to cross the bridge, tragedy struck. The two constables were ambushed. Thomas Miller was immediately killed, and though Thomas Cooper, mortally wounded, managed to hang in the saddle and head back to town to sound the alarm. How long can he hold on, given his multiple wounds? If he can just make it to his friend Jonathan Burt's garrisoned home, present-day Elmwood in Maine. Just a few more yards. Having finally arrived, Thomas Cooper pulls up to the front stoop and falls from his horse. Dead. The Indian fort at Long Hill. I believe that the natives were just as surprised as the townspeople to hear musket fire down at the Mill River. In my opinion, King Philip's men sent down a few scouts at the foot of Long Hill to keep an eye on the town until they were fully prepared for the assault. With the sudden arrival of Miller and Cooper at the foot of the hill, plans have changed. Time was of the essence. In a mad dash, they gathered their weapons and sprinted down the hill. And here is where they congregated. Over here. The first order of business is to destroy Pynchon's gristmill and sawmill. Now that was easy because it was located just a few yards from the ambush site. The Mill River once flowed right through here. Long hill straight up top. As soon as the Indian fort heard the gunshots from below, they rushed down to this area right here. After destroying Pynchon's gristmill and sawmill, which was located at this very spot, they headed downtown. Alas, the direful yell, so loud, so wild, so shrill, so clear, as if the very fiends of hell burst from the wildwood depths were here. As compared with an Indian war whoop, the howl of a wolf or the cry of a panther have no terrors to the forefathers. The main forces comprised mostly of the Hadley Indians, followed by the central mass Nipmucks, a few of the King Philip's men, and close by, the more timid Agawams. Some carried blazing pine knots, preparing to burn the houses, barns, and hay. And to the other shock of the inhabitants, leading the pack was none other than the well-known Indian Wakagan himself. He was the sachem who sold the land at Springfield some 40 years earlier to William Pynchon. After the sale, he settled upriver in Hadley, leaving his son as the new chief of the Agawams. And on this account, his son was more easily persuaded to join with his father's clan from Hadley. Another of these principal men cried out that he was the one that burnt Quabog and now would make them like to it. With the saw and the gristmill destroyed, they headed down Main Street. The party fired on the House of Corrections on the hill, the flames leaping high into the sky. The torch was applied to the deserted houses by the excited savages. They poured through the streets in great numbers. Heading farther down Main Street, Pentecost Bond, the wife of John Matthews, who lived at present-day Lombard Street, was butchered at her home as she was preparing to flee. Of course, the natives were fully aware that when Pynchon and the militia headed for Hadley the previous morning, that they left Springfield undefended. And with spies throughout the valley and in the town itself, they knew that the inhabitants would be barricaded in their garrisoned homes. News of the impending danger was received in Springfield late that night and was relayed to Hadley in Westfield the following morning. But as the sun did not rise until after 6 o'clock, the post rider did not set out in time to reach Westfield until 10 a.m. and Hadley until the middle of the forenoon. With Westfield being closer, they were the first to get the news. Captain Appleton quickly assembled his militia and headed in hot haste
following the Westfield River to the distressed town. Meanwhile, in Hadley, a few more hours would pass before Major Pynchon, upon getting the news, was able to muster the 200-man army at Hadley. The natives, anticipating the eventual arrival from the north of the Hadley troops and the possibility that the Westfield troops were also notified, the boys, not yet of fighting age, were placed in strategic locations. One such location was the Round Hill, today's Atwater Park, the Hungry Hill area. And the other area, Wharf Lane, preventing the Westfield troops from crossing the Connecticut. They moved farther down Main Street, the houses, the barns, all set to fire. One Indian got a pewter platter, which, holding up before his person, either in defense or defiance, an enraged townsman sent a bullet through both platter and Indian. The platter remained in the town for nearly two centuries. We now arrive at the garrisoned house at the corner of the present-day Loring and Main. With an estimated 10 families holed up in a single home, their aim was to keep the natives at a distance, while the natives' aim was to creep up close enough to torch the building and its inhabitants. The accuracy of the flintlock being less than 50 yards, every shot counted. One massive rush to the house could have deadly consequences. Head further down Main Street, Court Square, the meeting house. Snipers located in the towers have kept the natives at bay. It's only a matter of time before the troops from Hadley arrive. Before long, the whole town, from the mills on Mill River to Upper Ferry Lane, was a burning, smoking ruin. Nothing escaped but the garrisoned houses, the meeting house, and one or two houses near it. Meanwhile, the future Long Meadow, with over 100 of its inhabitants, stood in great fear. With plumes of smoke rising from the doomed town below, they dared not venture far from their own garrisoned homes, for they knew not if they were next. Also escaping the wrath was the west side of the mighty river. With over 60 family homes lining the banks, they also watched in horror. Just as they were wondering how long the town could endure this onslaught, Major Treat's forces from Westfield arrive on the West Springfield side of the river with a company of soldiers. Could they have got across, the Indians would have fled, but the latter kept them back. We now head to Wharf Lane on the east side, former home of Miles Morgan, present-day Peter Pan bus station. With the arrival of the forces from Westfield, five men went out of town and, although pursued by 20 Indians, carried over a boat which was filled with men. But the Indians, standing on the banks of the river, shot at them and shot one through the neck, who was not likely to recover. They durst not adventure to pass the river till Major Pynchon has come and the Indians gone. Meanwhile, on the corner of Main Street and Fourth Street, home of John Pynchon, present-day location, the student prince, his home is so heavily fortified and so well defended that the natives keep a safe distance and concentrate on his outbuildings, his cattle, and his crops. 2 hours have already passed since Major Treat and his troops had arrived on the west side of the bank. They dare not try to recross the Connecticut for fear of further casualties. The clock is ticking. It's close to 2 p.m. Meanwhile, William Pynchon and the 200-man militia were less than 3 miles from their doomed town, following what is basically Route 116 of today. The troops crossed the Chicopee River at the ford where Grape Street now is. From there, straight down Springfield Street. Perspiring with exertion and anxiety, they arrive at Round Hill. Anticipating their approach, the young Indian boys signaled the alarm. The Springfield men, whose wives and children, mothers and sisters, were in the sacked burning village, had finally arrived to the rescue.
They at last arrived on the scene. Their approach was the signal for the retreat of the Indians, so they saw none, besides Lieutenant Cooper and Thomas Miller, killed at the first onslaught. Pentecost Bond, wife of John Matthews, was also slain. Richard Waite and Edmund Pingvedes were shot, and later dying the following week of his wounds. That short autumn was a busy time for the survivors, as the sun set shortly after 5 o'clock and much was to be done before dark. Livestock was rounded up. Three graves were dug. Three bodies were interred. It was imperative that a report be made to headquarters. This Pynchon addressed to the pastor of the Hadley Church and sent it off by a post rider in the dark of night. The letter read, "I desire to give you an account of the sore stroke upon poor distressed Springfield, which I hope will excuse my late doing of it. On the 4th of October, our soldiers, which were at Springfield, I had called off, leaving none to secure the town because the commissioner's orders were so strict. That night, a post was sent to us that 500 Indians were about Springfield intending to destroy it on the 5th of October. That the town did not utterly perish is cause of great thankfulness. As soon as said forces appeared, the Indians drew off so that we saw none. Our endeavors here are to secure the houses and the corn that are left. Our people are under great discouragement and talk of leaving the place. We need your orders and directions about it. How to have provisions, I mean bread, for want of mill is difficult. The soldiers have already complained on that account. Although we have flesh enough, many of the inhabitants have no houses, which fills and throngs every room of those who have. Together with the soldiers, indeed it is very uncomfortable living here, but I resolve to attend what God calls me to do and stick to it as long as I can. I hope God will make up in himself what is wanting in the creature to me and to us all. And for the Agawams, never would they return to the land of their forefathers. Although now and then a wanderer appeared about the home of his childhood, never again did Springfield have a tribe of Indian neighbors.
Only when the last tree has died, and the last river been poisoned, and the last fish been caught, will we realize we cannot eat money. They came with a Bible and their religion. They stole our land and crushed our spirit, and now tell us we should be thankful to the Lord for being saved.
The remaining Connecticut River Valley Indians moved north to Canada and west to New York State. In just a 50-year time period, a once thriving culture throughout the Connecticut River Valley was reduced to a handful of small scattered villages. No longer to roam as they have for thousands of years.
Hi, John Kelly. I want to thank you for watching. If you have any questions or comments, you can contact me at jaykaylmnop1, jaykaylmnop1. That's my website. Thanks for watching.